when we think about these kids marching, as adults, we often think it's a simple decision. You either do or you don't. It's either right or it's wrong. But there's so many factors that play into literally the decision about whether they're going to step out or not. And I think it's important that we appreciate how complex it is for any given child. So for example, depending on the school itself and what the repercussions are from the school. So whether students are permitted or not, whether they will be punished or not, whether they will miss assignments or not, that weighs into it. Then if you can take it down to another level, what class are they in and what's happening in that class? And will they be missing something in a particular class? Then you can add in another factor, which is how many kids are also going to march, teenagers in particular, but all of us. We are swayed very often by who else is doing it and am I going to stand out? You add another factor in, and that's more of the personal factor. What does marching mean not to this child's parents or the school, but what does it mean to this child? You can add one more factor. What does this child know about how his or her parents or their school feels about the marching? So when you put all of that together, that's really what determines whether a child is going to march or not. So it's not as simple as their convictions only. And every teen is really making that decision, sometimes at a more unconscious level, but they're making that decision based on all of that. And that's what determines whether kids are marching or not.
And now, before we started this, we were talking about how down the road, you know, a lot of people will look back and be like, wow, you know, these children, they really banded together and did this. But right now, the whole focus is on, oh my goodness, they're walking.
Yes.
Talk to me a little bit about that.
So if we think about it right now, we have a bunch of teenagers. These are, we call them kids, but they're teenagers for the most part. And they are essentially engaging in civil disobedience. And so it's easy for us right now in the heat of this, there's so many political, societal issues going on with this topic right now, it's easy for us adults to make snap judgments about whether this is good or bad, right or wrong. But if you step back, or if we look at it in 5 or 10 years from now, the fact that teenagers essentially banded together and practiced civil disobedience in a national forum, whether you believe in it or not, from a human behavior standpoint, is pretty amazing. And when I say amazing, again, I'm not putting a judgment on it. What I'm saying is, probably for one of the first times in history, we had a national civil disobedience act that was moved by teenagers. And that's pretty remarkable, and it is a testament to the freedoms that we have in this country. Whether you believe in it or not, the fact that teenagers got up and decided in unison to walk out, even with adults supporting it or not supporting it, is a pretty remarkable action of human behavior.
Now, with them all coming together and doing this today, do you think in the future they're more likely to band together on more issues and really just make that change?
I do believe two things. I think one, there was a precedent that was set. I think you will see teenagers in the future pushing to make a statement about things that they believe in. That's one precedent. I think the second precedent is the extent to which this march fuels a fire that keeps going at the adult level absolutely can foster some change. What I think is more interesting, or equally interesting, is particularly for some of these older teenagers, the 17, 18 year olds, in a few years, in 3 years, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, now they're going to be in a position potentially to be in those, in the political sphere, to be in a position where they could be making decisions. And so really, depending on how long this stretches out, you may have the very kids who are marching now be in politics in a few years making decisions. So we never know until we look back on it. I do think it's important, though, that we understand that the decisions these kids made to march today were complex, and we shouldn't oversimplify it. We should not tell kids this is simply right or simply wrong, because getting up in the middle of class to leave is determined by so many factors beyond just the cause. And that's really important from a psychological standpoint.
Now, the teens who did decide to participate today, if they did get in trouble at their school, because I know different schools had different ideas on this, if they did get in trouble today for participating, do you think that that could affect them negatively in the future, the psychological issues?
You have to think about, and anybody deciding to march, any teen deciding to march, is basically weighing the risks versus the rewards. And so they're fully aware that if I march, depending on what the rules are at school, I may or may not get in trouble. And so if they're going to get in trouble, the teen is really making a decision, does this matter to me opposite what I'm marching for? Now, you have lots of factors playing into that. That is, teens have a harder time sort of thinking about future implications. Also, when there are groups of them, it is more of a groupthink phenomenon, and they may not be thinking how it impacts them. But I will say this, that most of the schools, and I can't speak for it completely nationally, but most of the schools, the penalties that they were imposing were not so severe that it would persuade most of the kids not to march. So really what teenagers are weighing is, am I willing to take some level of punishment that won't ruin my future, but could ruin my day, could ruin my week, might ruin my month? And that's really what they're weighing. Will there be long-term psychological consequences? Probably not in most cases. I do think where you're going to see any sort of emotional consequences is not so much at the teen versus the school level, but the teen versus the family level. So to the extent that the teen's beliefs are in conflict with parents' beliefs, then it becomes a more complicated issue.
Now, what is something that parents need to keep in mind if they do have a very strong-willed child that has completely different beliefs than what the parents do? What's something that those parents really need to keep in mind during all of this?
It's very hard to see your child go against your beliefs. As parents, sometimes we think that we've failed. As parents, sometimes we think that we have not instilled those beliefs strong enough. But teenagers as a whole, part of their job in development is to figure out what they believe in and what they don't, and to test the limits of society. That's their brain developing. And so as a parent, my recommendation is, even though you may not believe in what your child is doing, even though it may go against what you're doing or what you believe in, to the extent that you can talk to your child, try to understand what their motivations were to do this, even if you're in a position to agree to disagree, that's a much healthier approach than simply imposing a punishment on your child because they did something that was against your beliefs. When you have a teenager, even though they're not an adult yet, they're in a much better position to have a conversation, and you will get more respect from your teenager and you'll get more response from your teenager if you talk to them about how and why that goes against your beliefs.
Okay, and now pretty much the same question, just reversed. Say I'm a teen and I want to march, but my parents are all against this. What would be the best way to approach your parents to have that conversation of, hey, you know, I know you believe in this, but I really feel strongly this way?
Ultimately, as a teen, you are at a disadvantage. You live in your parents' house. And so as much as you can go and be honest and educated about why you want to engage in something, that's what parents are more likely to respect. I think a lot of times what parents will not respect is, I'm just marching because. I'm just doing it because everyone else is doing it. Or I'm just doing it because, and then the information is not correct. So as a teenager, you should express your beliefs. It's okay to express your beliefs. You should be educated about those beliefs. But ultimately, you have to understand that you are in your parents' house. And ultimately, those rules are going to be dictated by your parents. If you choose to break those rules, just like breaking rules at school, there's going to be a consequence. What I hope, though, is that parents and teens will see this as what we're trying to see this for the country, which is an opportunity to understand where they're both at. An opportunity to understand why they believe in the same thing or why they believe in different things. Ultimately, that is how teenagers learn about the world, and ultimately, that's how parents learn about their teens. Hard and fast rules, hard and fast reasons about why this is happening, way oversimplified. This is complicated, it's psychological, it's social, it's emotional, it's legal, it's political, and so we can't kid ourselves and say it's just a right or wrong, because even if we believe it's a right or wrong, there are so many other factors driving this in terms of what teens do, that it's too complicated to just say yes versus no, right versus wrong.
Okay. Now, a second ago you touched on everyone else is doing it, so I'm gonna do it. So let's talk about that a little bit, with like the peer pressure to join in.
Yep.
On these markets.
So there is conformity is a very significant influence on us. Do what everybody is doing or don't go against the grain. And so particularly at schools where there was a majority of kids either marching or not marching, one or the other, the pressure to go against that is huge. And so what I know you will see are lots of teens who maybe didn't march when they wanted to, or lots of teens who maybe marched when they didn't want to, because the pressure from peers, from the group, is going to be strong. That happens to all of us. And what we try to educate teens on, and people, is sometimes you do conform. Sometimes you do what the group does. You just need to be honest with yourself. And you need to ask yourself, you know, I may have gone against what I really believe, so how else can I express what I really believe? And that's just a part of being a teenager. It's also a part of being human.
Okay, and you just mentioned how else can we show what we really believe in. Now we have these marches. What other things do you feel would be beneficial psychologically for these teens to do?
So lots of the schools are implementing multiple programs and multiple activities to combat school violence, to create tighter bonds between students. And so whether you marched or you didn't march, look at the other activities that the school is offering and decide, well, maybe I can participate in that. If you feel that the march wasn't something that you wanted to do, or if you were very much against the march, ask yourself as a teen, okay, where do I stand on this issue? Because the issue itself is complicated. It has to do with violence. It has to do with safety. It has to do with gun control. It has to do with mental health. So there's so many places for you as a teen and you as a parent to sort of plug in and say, this is what I'm passionate about. This is what is important to me, that regardless of whether you marched or you didn't, or you marched and you didn't want to, or you didn't march and you didn't march and you wanted to, finding those aspects of this issue and plugging in and doing something about it. It may be mental health, it may be safety, it may be gun violence, it may be understanding better what the laws and the rules and the regulations are. There's lots of opportunity now to engage in society, and that's what you can do to reconcile whatever you may be feeling. The last thing is, it's okay to be confused. You know, particularly as a teenager, but as adults, we're confused. So it's okay to be confused and to talk to your parents, talk to your teachers, talk to administrators, try to take information in. You don't have to, at age 13 through 18, have a formulated decision on this yet. Because you know what? As adults, many of us don't either. So this is something to grapple with, and that's okay as a teenager.
And now, whenever they do think about these things, all these different issues, because these are all very big talkers right now, what is just one thing that you think needs to stand out in their mind so that they do protect themselves psychologically, mentally, when they're thinking of all these things? What is the one most important thing to keep in mind?
It is so easy to get overwhelmed as a teenager right now. It is so easy to feel this is a huge subject, it's way beyond my control. And to some extent that is true. And as much as they are watching adults argue about different positions and different political positions and different legal positions, the one thing that teenagers can remember is, regardless of sort of what side of the political aisle people may be, what side of sort of the religious aisle, religious faith, there are no parents that want to see a child harmed. There are no adults that want to see our kids be in harm's way. And the one thing as a teenager that you can rest on is, even if you look out at us adults and say you're not doing a very good job of keeping us safe, you can know that collectively we want you to be safe. We're trying to keep you safe. We may be fumbling, we may be arguing, we may be disagreeing, but as a teenager, to understand it's not your responsibility solely. You can be a part of it, but know that as much sort of arguing and conflict as you see, the one thing that everybody agrees on, including teens, is we want teens to be safe. We're trying to get at that. We may not be doing an optimal job, but everybody is focused on that.